Good morning and a very warm welcome to the fourth meeting of the Constitution Europe External Affairs and Culture Committee in 2022. Our first agenda item is a decision on taking business in private, and at the committee, the committee are invited to agree to take item four in private. Are we all agreed? Thank you very much for that agreement. Our next agenda item is our inquiry into the Scottish Government's international work, and the committee is conducting this inquiry, and this will be the fifth panel on this topic this morning, and we will hear from today James Hampson, Director, UK Region External Affairs at the British Council, and Professor Andrea Nolan, University of Scotland's International Committee Convener. Can I welcome you both to the meeting this morning? We're going to thank you also for your very comprehensive briefings that you provided to the committee, and we're going to move to questions. And I wonder if to remind everyone, we have two panels this morning, so do please try and keep contributions concise, and that's for my committee members to asking their questions, please. So if I could maybe open with a question to Mr. Hampson, it's on the education work. As a former convener of the Education Skills Committee in the previous session, a strong interest in this area. And really what I wanted to ask was about the school's engagement level and the work that you described in your paper then. From the point of view that when it comes to schools, it tends to be leadership either at local authority level or head teachers that drive forward some of these initiatives. And I really wanted to get a feeling if all local authorities are engaging with the British Council in this work, or is there a sort of geographic element to who's actually engaging with the British Council on the schools exchange programmes and the projects that are on offer? Mr. Hampson, thank you.
No, thank you very much. And it's a great pleasure to be with the committee this morning. And thank you for receiving our evidence and giving me an opportunity to speak. So schools is an important part of what we do as an organisation. I mean, obviously, what we try and do is build a bridge between Scotland and the rest of the world. What I'm going to do, actually, in order to answer your question, I don't have the data that you're asking for. And it's not a great start for me to look at all local authorities, but perhaps I could follow up in writing, because I have a huge amount in front of me in terms of examples of our education work, but I can't give you a precise answer to the question on how many local authorities. So, convener, if you could bear with me on that, I can get back to you just with the accurate data.
That's absolutely fine. Thank you very much, Mr. Hampson. I wonder if I could perhaps ask Professor Nolan a question. And again, from my previous experience, we very much value the Erasmus programme in Scotland, and many of the witnesses have lamented the loss of this. So I was just wondering if you could expand a little bit on what your aims would be for an ideal new mobility scheme, and perhaps a little bit of your insight into what funding and backup that might require.
Thank you. Thanks for the opportunity to come here. So obviously we were disappointed to not be part of Erasmus, or the Erasmus Plus, the follow-on programme, particularly as it's about twice the size of the previous one. But what we're doing at the moment is we've all had 17 of the 19 higher education institutions in Scotland have received funding from the Turing Scheme. We're trying to make success of that. The positive aspect of the Turing Scheme is that it was initially 1 year with funding of somewhere around 100 million, I've not quite got that right, but around that. And it's now been extended to 3 years. One of the challenges for us, if I have a student coming in to first year now, they might not be going abroad until their third year. So 3 years is a very short time in a higher education planning context. So that is a challenge. In terms of, I suppose, the big loss for another positive, is that a focus on shorter term exchanges, which I think is a good thing, particularly for people with caring responsibilities, or people may have jobs, you know, that they really need the income that they can't actually afford to go away for a semester. So there are positives we could take from touring. A real challenge is that lack of inward mobility. Now, so an ideal programme for us would have some of the features of touring, i.e. that short-term mobility. It would, but it would also have that ability for inward students coming into our universities. It's an interesting one, the and I know Scottish Government is thinking about a student mobility scheme. Another piece of recent kind of information is the Welsh Government are setting up an international learning exchange programme, so trying to replicate Erasmus. They have committed, we think, around 9 to 10 million for that. Now, the Welsh sector's probably student headcount, well, it would be only half the size, maybe a bit less, than the Scottish sector. So it's a significant, it's not an enormous amount of money in the context of the higher education budget, but it is a significant investment, and we don't see any funding in it in the draft Scottish Government budget for next year. So the ideal one would build on, would have those reciprocal relationships. All of us are frantically trying to build them. You know, my institution, Edinburgh Napier, has reached out to 65 of our Erasmus partners to say, can we have bilateral joint exchanges? I've got agreement from, I think, about 40% of them so far. But you can imagine what was a wonderfully organised, multifaceted scheme. Suddenly, we're all doing these bilaterals. So the ideal would have that a broad-based scheme where you weren't doing bilaterals and you would have funding for inward-bound students.
Thank you very much for your answers. I'm now going to move to questions from committee members, and I could invite Mr. Golden to begin. Thank you.
Thank you, convener. And I'd like to ask the same question to both panellists, but perhaps start with Professor Nolan. And I think touched on some aspects of this in the questioning from the convener. But in both the University of Scotland and the British Council Scotland submissions, the importance of Scottish Government's as yet unpublished international education strategy has been highlighted. What are your main asks for inclusion in this strategy, and what support commitments from the Scottish Government would you like to see in it?
Me? Yes. I'm glad you raised that early on, because we're very excited about the International Education Strategy. And I know we've spoken to Scottish Government officials on many occasions about this. We have offered our vast evidence base from across the university sector of priority markets for us, of how student recruitment works, where our big research partnership. I suppose a key ask is that we get one, and get one quickly, and really commit us all to a set of targets that will deliver real impact for Scotland. We'd like to see a set of key priority markets and territories. I have some priority markets for student recruitment. It would be others for international research, but we'd like to set in that context of Scottish Government's international ambitions. And particularly targets around international student recruitment, but also about how we attract and retain talent. That is a huge, not a huge challenge, because the Scottish higher education sector is so well regarded internationally, but it's a very competitive market for talent. So we'd like to see a scheme around how we could attract and retain talent. We'd like to see connections between Scottish Government departments, you know, where trade would connect with the learning directorate, so as that we are coherent in how, you know, foreign direct investment and how we trade, etc., is not really in the higher education directorate or the education directorate, but clearly synergy and cohesion is really, really important. We'd like to see a commitment to the growth of online, you know, how we can support the growth of online students and transnational students, which tends often to be forgotten. So we think of international student recruitment and research. But, for example, my institution teaches 4,000 students overseas with partners where we're awarding Edinburgh and Napier degrees. And they're fantastic partnerships. We've been doing it for 25, 30 years. We have wonderful alumni who are all passionate about Scotland and about Edinburgh and Napier University. So there are some of the elements that I'd like to see in a strategy. It doesn't have to be complicated. I think just getting one out to unite us behind what we want Scotland to be in terms of international education is really important. And something we're an investor or contributor to Scotland is now. And something that's come up is how we market Scottish education and looking at how we could do this in a shared manner with an appropriate digital platform, because I think that would make an enormous difference to Scotland as a distinct brand in the education sphere. Sorry, I've gone on a little bit.
Not at all. That was very interesting, Professor Nolan. Just a quick supplementary. You mentioned about kind of key target territories for recruitment. Do you have a broad idea of where those might be?
Well, I can tell you where they are, where we get most of our international students. I mean, big recruitment markets for Scotland are China, USA. If we now include EU countries where we want to keep our links, Germany would be a big one. So we would, for my institution, Nigeria, Malaysia, Hong Kong used to be, but so there are different areas, but and some of the Scottish Government's focus might be in a different place to where my individual institution is, but with a set of priority markets underpinned by good digital branding and marketing and awareness, we all benefit.
Thanks, that was very interesting. I'll move on to James Hampson now, if you could highlight what you would like to see from the Scottish Government's international education strategy.
Thank you for the question. I think Professor Nolan has covered some of it. I mean, so from our perspective, we've just published a report on Scotland's higher education assets, and I think what that our research points to is that the education system is the jewel in the crown. So I think making the most of that mobility. I mean, certainly when we were talking to our colleagues in Europe, but beyond the EU as well, there's a real appetite for engagement and mobility between markets that are important to Scotland, markets that are important to us, which includes the EU, but of course we look at the whole world as well. And I think those two things, really understanding that Scotland has this incredible asset that shapes the way people perceive Scotland, that has an enormous soft power, that helps with trade, and then you have a really strong plan around mobility. And of course, where we can help, looking at the whole of the UK as we do as an organisation, is on how that marketing works on the ground. And I've seen that when I've worked in Egypt, I've seen it when I've worked in Pakistan, where the Scottish Government are investing in the Scottish Scholarships Programme as well, which we deliver for them. So I think if we can bring those things together, added to what Professor Nolan has said, I think Scotland will be heading in a good direction.
Thank you, panel. Thank you, convener.
Mr. Hampson, I think you wanted to come in on my first question about the local authorities from the chat.
I did. It's 32.
So they're all engaging.
Yeah, basically. A third of all schools and 32 local. So I did some. My team have just come to my rescue.
Thank you. That's very helpful. I'll now move to questions from Ms. Boyack, please.
Thanks very much, convener. And it was very good to read both the submissions that we received. Can I ask my first question to Professor Nolan, please? And it's really to follow up the point you made about a replacement to Erasmus going forward, given the importance of it academically in Scotland. And I was just looking at the new Welsh scheme. You said it was about 9 million. I think it's actually the launch this week said it was a £65 million international exchange scheme that they've just launched, with 15,000 participants from Wales going overseas and 10,000 participants coming to study or work in Wales. So presumably a Scottish equivalent would be significantly more students. And they've also targeted non-traditional backgrounds to improve learning opportunities for people with additional learning needs, which I thought looked quite progressive. Can you say a bit about what you would be looking for in terms of a future Erasmus approach, whether it was something along the TAFE approach, or what would suit us in Scotland, given that the academic and the cultural exchange is good in terms of our overall soft power, but I'm presuming also significant in terms of the economy of how our colleges and universities operate going forward?
I mean, international mobility, you know, it's one of those things that the it used to be quoted, I don't know if that's the case anymore, that employers, you know, that, you know, if they saw someone had gone abroad for a semester abroad or a year abroad, it was a real brownie point, if you like, a real persuader to bringing them into the firm. And it's really about the motivation, the challenges that people have to overcome to go to another country. They may have to study in another language. They may have had to develop the language before they go. So I, and I think all my colleagues across Scotland, I'm a passionate believer in the benefits of that. I think the aspect about the Turing that I really thought was wonderful was the short-term ability. I mean, in Napier, we have students who have been, you know, on study trips for even 2 weeks or 3 weeks. We've had people who've gone to parts of Africa and various and Europe. And the benefits, I mean, they come back and they talk about life-changing experiences. So I think, you know, short-term exchanges, which you didn't have with Erasmus, are hugely beneficial because, like, well, 40-45% of my students at Napier are mature students. So they can't necessarily just up and go for a year or for a semester. I think a focus, as you've said, with the Welsh and apologies about the finance, I think maybe I'm talking on a yearly basis, but the benefits, the focus on people from you know, MD20, more socially deprived backgrounds, and they should be well funded. So when you're funding them, you need to fund them properly. But combining short term with a progressive approach is truly, I would love to see that as a feature carried through, and less of the focus on people having to do a year abroad. So I suppose they would be the main elements for me, the improvements I saw in Turing, but also continuing that support for inward students. Because, you know, something I've sometimes noted at Edinburgh Napier and did previously when I was at Glasgow, often it was the Europeans, the Erasmus students or the students who came and study abroad, they were the ones leading societies for a year, or, you know, they really enriched the culture and the experiences of our Scottish domiciled and home students. So a strong push for me on the progressive approach targeted, because we know that students from socioeconomically deprived backgrounds, and even when they have their degrees, they don't have that social capital that others may have as they progress maybe to further study or into graduate level jobs.
Okay, thanks. Those points are well made. And presumably from the academic side as well, in terms of lecturers and research, strengthening international relationships and exchanges is actually very beneficial for our further and higher education systems as well.
It's a very good point. I didn't mention that, of course, Erasmus is open to staff as well, to move and to be mobile. And while we have research screens, we hope, if the Association to Horizon Europe goes through, which support mobility of researchers, absolutely, the Erasmus scheme funded staff exchanges, which were often the prelude to building deep partnerships for further student exchange, but also research partnerships.
Thank you for that. And can I basically move the same kind of area of questioning on to James Hampson from the British Council? Just to follow up that exchange with Professor Nolan about that, in your report you talk about Scotland's soft power, and that we were actually, in research you did, we were first in the categories of education, enterprise and digital, and second in the cultural category. So I was wondering, Mr. Hampson, what more you think we need to be doing to capture those benefits and going forward, what opportunities you think need to be developed, both for exchange opportunities and, you know, linking into that, not just further in higher education, but at a school level as well?
Well, I mean, start with a really short response. We believe in more outward mobility and inward mobility, not less. So, you know, all the advent of all schemes, whether it's a Scottish scheme in the future and the Welsh programme, as well as Turing, are great things. So you're right to point to the research. I mean, cultural relations and soft power can build attractiveness and influence, and it also builds trust. So we know that people out there in the world are twice as likely to trade, come and do business with the whole of the UK, or invest if they've had a strong cultural relations experience. And I use cultural relations as a bit of a catch-all term here to describe the work the council does in arts and education, and of course in the English language. So there are benefits generated economically and in terms of perception, and also in terms of reputation and influence. And to point back to the comment I made earlier, the Scotland has this jewel in the crown in terms of higher education, but also in its arts and its creative sector, which of course has a world-class reputation, not only as an exporter of brilliance, but also as a destination, particularly around the summer months. And we're looking forward to getting back on the streets of Edinburgh this year as well. I think making the most of your hub network as well, that's a really important part. Our experience of having a global network is that being there on the ground, developing relationships, developing insight, developing influence over the choices that young people and their parents make for their future. We want, as an organisation, young people to come and study in the UK. We want young people to take a UK qualification, and we very much want young people to see the UK, and in this case, obviously, to see Scotland as a place that they can connect their values to, but also think about investing in as well. So I think it's really about making the most of the government hubs, and we've made an offer to the Scottish Government around how we might work more closely together. My new chief exec met with Angus Robertson in September, and that's something we really, really want to do. There's a huge demand in Europe as well, through our colleagues and our officers there, for continued engagement with Scotland, and really around mobility for arts education institutions, working with policymakers, and connecting Scotland to those markets, which we know are important to you as well. But I think it is about making the most of what you already have, thinking about what value for money looks like, what are the KPIs that you're going to put in, what is a good outcome for Scotland for its investment, and then really thinking about the potential of the government hubs, and then how you connect with organisations like mine, and how you work, obviously, with the Foreign, Commonwealth and Development Office to make sure that we're all working for the whole of the UK, a commitment, I would add, that we take incredibly seriously.
So what would be the top change or top additional initiatives you think that would actually help deliver that?
I think, I mean, having a unifying strategy that brings not only education and arts together, but having one international strategy, and I know work is underway on that, but how you unify and bring it all together, I think, is really, really important. And I think that will then be the arrowhead through which everything else is delivered.
And presumably doing that as an urgent priority from your perspective?
I think so, because it's certainly the case that Scotland has a huge amount of presence and positive reputation in the world. So it's a great place to start from. I mean, our 2019 report, as you know, really put Scotland up there. And so I think it's building on that and making the most of what you already have.
Okay, thanks very much. Thanks, convener.
Thank you. Could I invite Mr. Ruskell, please?
Thanks. Thanks, convener. Can I just stay with James Hampson then on that topic of the hubs? I wonder if you could give us some practical examples of how British Council works with the existing hub network, and also what your thoughts are on the expansion of the Scottish Government's hub network. We had some information from the Cabinet Secretary, I think a couple of weeks ago, indicating that the Copenhagen hub is already being developed, as a director, I think, being appointed at the moment for that. So what would you see the the opportunities being with that hub, and then perhaps the Warsaw hub in the future as well.
That was Copenhagen and Warsaw. So we have worked closely with the hubs, particularly in Europe and elsewhere. The focus, one of the great examples that we can point to is our work with Creative Scotland, and we're going to be launching our arts assets report, which is the companion piece to the higher education work that we've done. It will be an analysis of the distinct aspects of Scottish arts and the culture sector that are different from the rest of the UK, and that really help Scotland stand out in the crowd. So it's about telling the story. So I think that's a live example that we can work with you on. I mean, on Copenhagen and Warsaw, we, again, back to the other answer I gave around mobility, around connecting policymakers, and how Scotland is able to be both attractive and influential in that space. I mean, also then there's the broader question of Pakistan, China, and India, and how you connect there. And I think the world outside of the EU is obviously, and it goes without saying, is an important part of how we see things. And I think really that's potentially the question about what does the Scottish government investment look like beyond EU and into those much bigger markets in Indo-Pacific. And Indo-Pacific is a big priority for British Council. It was a standout feature of the Integrated Review, which was published by the UK government last year. But I would be thinking beyond Europe and also into, you know, how do we really maximise our impact where you already have a presence and reputation, for example, in Pakistan. That would be the sort of where I would be thinking going into the future.
Right. I mean, practically then, what would the British Council be doing in relation to a Copenhagen hub? I mean, where do you see the opportunities? Is it about, you know, creative sector screen? Is it, you know, what?
Well, so we have an audit. So we have a Nordics cluster ourselves because we no longer have an office in Copenhagen. But I think for that part of Europe, I think it would be about education and arts, connecting education and arts institutions. I think it would be about looking at the exchange of policymakers. And I think, again, Scotland has a great track record of exporting its success in assessment and in access to the university sector, which Professor Nolan will know more about. I mean, Copenhagen is a challenging one for us because we're no longer present on the ground. So actually, it's a great opportunity to work together and think about what we could do together in that territory. And because we're operating digitally and remotely, so we've taken some decisions recently about thinking about our presence differently. So we're working on a hub and spoke model in some parts of Europe as well. In Warsaw, we have a big fixed presence. It's one of our oldest operations in Poland. And again, our commitment as an organisation to working for the whole of the UK means that when that's up and running, our director in Warsaw and your director in there too can work together in thinking about what that looks like. But our focus, of course, is on arts, education and the English language. So what does that mean and what does that look like and how do we benefit and how do we measure it for Scotland working together on the ground?
Okay, thanks. Reading your submission, I mean, you focus quite a lot on soft power.
Yep.
It's been described by some commentators slightly differently. Pat Kane describes a notion of fizzy power. It seems to be quite a kind of fluid concept. I'm just wondering, like, there's obviously tangible benefits there. How does that get pinned down? I mean, do you think that government should be saying, okay, like, there are some clear metrics and clear objectives here about how we measure soft power and how we account for that? Or not? I mean, is it something a bit more like a well-being indicator? If we're talking about building relationships and trust,
yeah,
obviously very valuable. But you know, it's not GDP, is it? So what?
No.
Where do we incorporate this in terms of government thinking and objectives? And how do we measure it?
So I think we have been able to think and demonstrate that the return on investment in soft power can generate economic benefit, as well as reputational benefit, as well as the influence that it all gives you. So I think the short answer is we should, not least because we're spending taxpayers' money in our case, and we think that you can do this in a number of ways. So We run a perception survey every year across 20,000 people across the G20 that looks at their engagement and their understanding and then attractiveness towards the UK as a whole. So we don't yet have the Scotland Cup, but we are going to soon, and I'll be able to share that with the committee. I'd be happy to do that. So we have seen that you're more likely to trade, as I said before, with the UK if you've had a cultural relations soft power experience with the UK, which is a great thing to be able to do. We then have a number of partnerships across the world. So we measure business outcomes. So, for example, in our UK and Japan season, we showed that for each pound invested in that season, a further £8 was generated for arts organisations across the UK. And then, of course, there are partnerships that are built as a result of it. So in the case of the UK Korea season in 2017-18 and Indonesia, we were able to build partnerships that sustain themselves going forward. So I think there are a number of things that you can do. How do you build trust? What does trust mean as a result of your soft power intervention in terms of trade, in terms of partnerships, in terms of perception, and crucially, we think, in terms of influence as well? It was worth bearing in mind why the council was founded. It was to, as part of the effort to face down fascism in the 30s, and influence remains still an important part of who we are and what we do. I hope that's helpful.
Yeah, no, that is helpful. Can I just briefly turn then to Professor Nolan? And you mentioned earlier on about you know, Horizon Europe and some of the delays in terms of potentially getting associate membership to that. Can you just talk a little bit about what those delays are, how those have manifested themselves, and what your hopes are for a resolution to that?
Well, there's a current blockage. So UK government said we would associate with Horizon Europe, which the whole of the Scottish across the UK and the Scottish sector was absolutely delighted. It's a 95.5 billion research programme over the period to 2027. But there's currently a blockage, and that blockage sits at the Commission. And it appears to be linked on to the Northern Ireland Protocol and it being resolved. And so the Horizon Europe bids opened in early 2021. Scotland, in the first tranche, has won four of the very prestigious European Research Council bids, two of those at the University of Edinburgh, two at the University of Glasgow. But they can't access the money or the funding because we're not officially associated, so they can't sign grant agreements. Now, I can't remember, at some point last year, the UK government, at the end of the year, agreed to underwrite and provide the funding for the successful applicants to the Horizon Europe who were unable to sign grant agreements. I think most of us thought it was just, you know, slow process. But now being linked to the Northern Ireland Protocol, we believe this is potentially very damaging. The next big round, I think, of applications is around March, June or awards this year. And we would be pushing UK government, are you going to underwrite those? They will know much more about the progression of the politics around the Northern Ireland Protocol. But meanwhile, you can imagine this is really high up our academic researchers' worry list. Are you going to, you know, invest so much time in developing that grant application, keeping going with it, if you're not sure if it's going to be funded? Well, you're not sure if you're going to get the underwriting funding. So I think it has the potential, well, the impasse is damaging. Not just the UK research and the Scottish research, but also the EU research, because we are highly valued partners in the EU research ecosystem. So we're very anxious about lost opportunities, about potential damage to partnerships, and desperate to get this resolved. But at the moment, as I say, we're at an impasse.
Okay, thank you. Back to you, Convener.
Thank you very much, Mr. Ruskell. Can I invite Dr. Allen to ask his questions?
Professors, most recently you mentioned the Northern Ireland Protocol.
Alistair, could you restart? Sorry, we missed the start of that. Sorry.
Okay. Can you hear me now?
Yes, we can. Thank you.
Thank you. Just to say, Professor Nolan, you've just been talking there about some of the stresses that the academic sector has faced in coping with events, let's say, post-Brexit, and most recently you mentioned the Northern Ireland Protocol. Can you give us a picture of how much academic time or university time is being devoted to trying to resolve some of these problems, and how universities cope with that and how they work together to overcome it? Essentially trying to recreate things that used to exist or find new opportunities.
I probably will underestimate, because if I just go back to the Erasmus situation, so my university, which is a mid-size in Scotland, has written to 65 partners to work out, you know, how we will do international credit transfer and mobility, student mobility. So then we're following up, we've got, and that's one university out of 19. So that will be replicated across, and people spend time, significant time, in that type of activity. In terms of the research, we don't have an ability to influence the resolution of the Northern Ireland Protocol individually. What we do in this context is work with Universities UK, which is an umbrella organisation and membership for all the universities in the UK, and they have an international unit which liaises closely with UK government, also liaises with UK Research and Innovation, you know, the big funding, UK research funding body, to highlight the difficulties, put pressure on trying to get a guarantee that, you know, the next round of EU applications, if successful, would be funded. They work closely with relevant UK government departments, and we channel most of our work and effort through them, because as an individual institution, I would have very little sway. So huge amounts of energy around mobility. We're all doing our own thing, hiring staff. That's added, you know, EU staff from the EU. But for the big Horizon Europe issue, this impasse, we're channeling our efforts through mostly UK and also wherever we can with MSPs, ME, and MPs.
Thank you. You also raised another subject. You talked about online learning and the opportunities that exist around that. Undoubtedly, I'm sure that there are opportunities. There's also the aim, obviously, that you mentioned of attracting people to Scotland. Are there any tensions between these two things? Are there any potential threats around that, or is it something that you're confident you can manage the new landscape? I mean, many of us don't quite know what the new landscape of online learning looks like, so perhaps you could say a bit about that.
Yeah, I don't see any tensions in terms of you know, online learning somehow in competition with students wanting to come to Scotland. I mean, higher education is just growing massively around the world, and the demand for it, for that kind of those knowledge-based economies. I think COVID has helped us all understand the potential, excuse me, of online learning. Excuse me, I have something stuck in my throat. And the demand. I mean, in Edinburgh Napier, we started to do some online learning maybe about 6 or 7 years ago. And every year we recruit more and more students, because there are students who cannot, again, they might be caring, they might be mature, who cannot come here. But there's a massive demand for Scottish, probably for UK students to come and study and live here. And the post-study work visa has made that very attractive. And we've seen ongoing, despite COVID pandemic, we have seen ongoing increases in my institution, I think in virtually all of across Scotland, of students wanting to come, study in Scotland, have an experience here, live here and work here for a couple of years, and then take those experiences back. So I just see opportunity abounding. And you know, when there have been difficulties, for example, some of the students who wished to join us last month in January, couldn't get here because of maybe visa offices being shut because of COVID in their country. We were able to facilitate their early learning by engaging them with online activities, but that's not stopped them wanting to come. They're still coming, they're still booking their flights because they want that experience of being in another country. So I just see oodles of opportunity for Scotland, and hence my kind of excitement. And I hope this year we get the international education strategy out there that says this is where we're going, these are our priorities, and get that real government support behind us all.
Thank you. Mr. Hanson, related to that last point Professor Nolan made, but also relating to the point you made about how you unify international strategy and international policy, because one of the traditional ways of doing that is through diplomacy, and you touched on Scotland's offices abroad. How do cultural organisations get the most out of those offices, and should we have more of them?
So on the last question, okay, of course, more the better, right? I think you know, within the realms of what's affordable. I mean, our view is that by working with the Scottish Government and Creative Scotland on the Arts Asset Report, we're able then to help Scotland tell the world its story. So I think we would obviously encourage and want to work with as many parts of the Scottish machine, whether that's government, whether that's within the sector itself, because, you know, we have this incredible relationship that we've been in Scotland since the 1940s, been in Scotland. We opened our office in Edinburgh in the 1940s. We helped found the Edinburgh International Festival as well. So we have deep roots, of course, as we do right across the UK. And so I think the idea that we can help Scotland grow its international profile and presence is something which is completely aligned to who we are. And I would be having the same conversation with the Welsh Government in Cardiff, the exec in Belfast, and of course our colleagues in London as well. And, you know, diplomacy manifests itself in different ways. And I think it's about playing to strengths here. And I think Scotland is really, really clear on what it's good at, where its strengths lie. And I think culture and education and how that connects to trade is a great place to be starting with. So more presence, more profile, more people out there in the world, and building partnerships with organisations like mine, I think is the way to go. I mean, there is just to add, so there's a long, long list of things that we do that we would have put in the evidence. I mean, we're an organisation that is entirely committed to making this work.
Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Allen. Is that you finished with questions?
Yes, thank you, Camilla. Yeah.
Thank you very much. Can I invite Ms. Minto, please?
Thank you, convener, and thank you, panel. This has been very informative, and I'm kind of reflecting on what you're saying very much from an education, a culture, and a design perspective. You know, the work that you do is reflecting Scotland and Scots to the world, but also the world to Scotland. So I'm interested, Mr. Hanson, I was having a look at some of the international collaborations that you've done, for example, Dundee Rep and the Scottish Dance Theatre with cities in India and the US, and then EGG with Newfoundland. I'm just interested to hear how these projects turned out, how they developed or how they're developing, and one-off projects, how do they expand, how do they lengthen their lives with your support? Mr. Hanson.
Thank you very much. I'm pleased that you're pleased to see this. It's great to hear. So, I mean, part of the success is having a brilliant team in Scotland that I have the pleasure of line managing. So Director Scotland and her team that are plugged in two ways. One, into our entire global network. So, you know, we operate all over the world. We connect with 745 million people a year. You know, we're a big organization that has presence in a lot of places. So making sure that my organization understands what it means to truly work for the whole of the UK. So I'm the guardian of that promise corporately. And then secondly, and making sure that we're plugged in to what's happening in Scotland through Creative Scotland, but also through the various partnerships that we have that manifest themselves in Venice, that manifest themselves in the International Culture Summit, and really bringing those things together. And bringing them together in a way that has meaning, That we believe what we do is a process. You know, it's a bit like democracy. It's not an event. It takes time to nurture and it takes time to pay off. The specifics of the projects that you asked for, I would love to be able to write to you and tell you how those are turned out. We operate within a big global program framework. So the British Council does English, we do arts, we do education right across the world, and everything sits in there. So I'd be happy to write and say, here's how we got on with those projects. But it's really about intelligence and insight on the ground in all of the parts of the world that we work in, and then how that fits with the aspirations of our Scottish partners, of Creative Scotland, of Scottish Government as well, and really bringing those together and doing it in a way, as I said, has meaning and helps change people's lives. You know, we're in the optimism business, and I think that's a really important thing for us all to hold on to. We're at that end of the spectrum, and it's really important that we help people realise their ambitions and aspirations.
Yeah, in a previous life, I worked with the BBC Scottish Symphony Orchestra, and they did a tour to China, and part of that was working with the British Council to provide education to children in China, and it was brilliant. So I think projects like that really add to Scotland's opportunity to approach different organisations in the world. So if you have a project, what's the plan at the end of the project? How is that expanded? How do you keep the connections? Do you have a kind of client, a relationship, a continuing relationship?
Yeah. So I mean, to your point, to your last comment and your next question, I mean, scaling it and measuring it are two incredibly important things. There's also then the third bit of that is giving it sustainability. I mean, yes. we do not have all the money in the world that we would like to have, which means, of course, what we're trying to do is help these partnerships stand on their feet. We do long-term tracking in terms of outcome and how these relationships are working. But really, the sure sign of success is these things stand on their own 2 feet, and that we are then able to measure what that meant, both for the people who were involved, the systems that sit around them, and maybe, you know, depending on the scale of it, what that meant in terms of reputation for the UK, reputation for the organisations, and then the influence that has, and then the longevity that it has. Can you measure it economically? Was there a trade benefit, for example? I mean, not everything gets measured purely through the trade lens, because some things you can't, but I think there are, you know, in the case of China, for example, our seasons there and our partnerships there, there are really clear benefits back to UK organisations. You know, the 1-in-8 ratio for Japan, it's an important part of saying this is good value for money, and also it has this much bigger impact in terms of society, in terms of reputation again, and ultimately that soft power impact that many of us think is an incredibly important part of how nations conduct themselves in the world.
I would reflect positively on that. Last week I attended the celebrations of Indian independence, and a large element of that was the cultural side and how Scotland and India have relationships.
Well, diaspora, I mean, it's an incredibly important part of this, and of course with India and also obviously Pakistan, you have these very vibrant large diaspora that are, you know, with individuals are hugely influential in British public life as well. I met the governor of Punjab when I was in Pakistan, who of course is a former MP in Scotland, and these links matter. They matter a great deal, and they matter because it also just how the UK shows itself to the world and how the UK is with itself as well. And I think we're all in the business of believing that's really, really important.
Thank you very much, Mr. Hansen. Professor Nolan, I'd like to kind of follow on from some of the questions that my colleague Dr. Allen was asking about distance learning as a result of the pandemic, and how we work with the practical side of education. So, for example, in my constituency, there's SAMS. And SAMS do an awful lot of work about biodiversity and climate change and such like. And they were explaining to me the impact of the drop of EU students. So I suppose my question is twofold, the practical side of studies how we're managing to continue that, but also how we can encourage, as you've said earlier, enriching the experience of students from Europe, but also the Scottish homegrown students in our institutions, given the recent leaving of the EU.
Thank you. With regards to the, well, particularly during the pandemic period, which with regards to the practical side, and we have a lot of, my university, a lot of practical based subjects.
Mm-hmm.
So when the pandemic hit, I won't say it was March time, so almost all universities were coming to the end of their second trimester or terms, yeah, whatever way, and we were going into exam time. So that was helpful in terms of ensuring students had the right practicals done by then. The really tough time was the lockdown in the second lockdown, January to March time, 2021. But we were allowed at the time with Scottish Government, if it was essential for students to do, you know, some practical work or go into the university, that if they didn't do that, they couldn't progress in their year or they couldn't graduate, mm-hmm, that we could do that. And I think you'll have seen we did that very safely and securely. And so we did graduate our students. That was a very, very challenging time. But, you know, the staff were enormously creative, particularly in, you know, our design and TV and radios, you know, our journalism. They were very creative in how they developed the skills of the students that would normally have been done in a lecture theatre. I mean, I had groups of students walking up our hills behind Craig Locker doing things because we were able to do them outdoors. So it wasn't ideal, but, you know, it is truly remarkable, I think, and a testament to the staff that we graduated virtually all our students. I mean, that's not to say it wasn't very difficult for many of our students and for our staff, but we did so. I mean, when students go, but if we didn't have a pandemic, if you look at, you know, online learning, students know what they're coming to do, and a lot of the online learning, for example, we think online programs around business studies where you don't need a practical basis, public health, that kind of thing. So they, you know, if I join an online course electively, I know what I'm getting. And also with the development of, you know, virtual reality and augmented reality, online learning is becoming pretty amazing, actually. Mm-hmm. In terms of enriching, yeah, we saw last year, it must have been 60% this year, 60% drop, certainly in my institution. I think across the board, it was maybe 50-50 to 60 to 70% drops in EU students coming. And what can I say? I feel really sad about that, very sad about that. And I suspect the drop will continue. We have a huge, as I mentioned earlier, there is still a tremendous demand and growth in demand for international students from around the world to come here. Mm-hmm. I hope that in due course, I mean, the Scottish Government gave us some funding, I think it was about £2.5 million this year, for scholarships for EU students to try and keep encouraging them to come. One of the key issues around scholarship funding is we need very good notice, because if someone's joining me next September, well, the closing date, you know, they'll be thinking about it in January. So you need to really have the scholarships in place. But hopefully that will happen in the future, and hopefully Scottish Government will commit. And this is, again, I go back to, if we have our international education strategy and it's clear these are the areas we want to target and this is why, and we join that up across departments, then all of the, you know, there'll be more coherence and we'll be able to align ourselves as appropriate to that. But what can I say? But I'm sad about the decline in EU students, and you know, they now would be paying international fees, whereas previously they were not. Tuition was free to them, and the Scottish public was funding them.
Great. Okay. Thank you for that, Professor Nolan. Thank you, convener.
Thank you. Could I invite Mr. Cameron, please?
Thank you, Convener, and yeah, good morning to the panel. I found this a fascinating evidence session. Could I ask one question to each of you, and then if there's time, a kind of roundup question? Firstly, to Professor Nolan, and really to ask you about the sort of balance between Europe and the rest of the world. You spoke about one of the benefits of the Turing scheme being short-term placements. I just wondered if it's also right that another benefit of the Turing scheme is that it is global, and whether you had any observations on the kind of balance between the EU, where we have long-standing academic relationships, but also what could be done sort of more widely across the world.
I think it's a very interesting question, and do I have an answer for what the balance should be? No, I don't. I think because with the EU, we were so well integrated, and we developed partnerships over so many years. You know, academics knew each other through research. It was easy to move around. That the loss of that feels enormous. We've always had maybe 50% of our students, exchange students, coming from other countries. We have a lot of study abroad students from the USA. Some universities have massive numbers coming to Scotland because of the links between Scotland and the USA and Canada, and they will continue. They're all done on bilateral exchange agreements, which really does increase the work and the effort. And, you know, if I want to start a new relationship or an exchange relationship with, say, a university in maybe Indonesia, that takes a lot of time and effort. I don't have a structure in place like I used to have with Erasmus. I may have my own agreement, but it might not work within, you know, an Indonesian context. So there's real opportunity to expand, but, you know, with my staffing base, I can't go into every country around the world and develop a bilateral, which is why, again, if we could have a Scottish government set of targets of where we're going to put our effort, that would be enormously helpful to me. But it's a good point about the balance, you know, a very good point. What is right? It certainly made mobility easy for Scottish students, and for them to go out with the European framework, and we were all signed up to that. It certainly made it easy and easier for us administering it.
Thank you for that. Could I turn to the British Council and to Mr. Hampson? One of the issues for this committee is how the Scottish Government's international efforts interact with what the UK government is doing, given the kind of constitutional responsibilities, which you'll be well aware of. And I just wondered if you had any, in terms of what the British Council does, and it, you know, you represent the UK as a region, as well as obviously Scotland within that. I just wondered if you had any views on how your work is seen through that kind of particular prism. I mean, we know, for instance, that several hubs, not all the Scottish Government hubs, but several of them are co-located within UK embassies. And I'd just be interested to hear about how that works in practice.
For the Council and the Foreign Office?
Yeah.
We are an NDPB of the Foreign Commonwealth Development Office, arm's length body. We are absolutely an operationally independent organisation, but aligned with what all four governments of the UK are trying to achieve in the world. Of course, our closest relationship is with SCDO ministers, because that's where the lion's share of our money comes from. On the ground, it works brilliantly. My experience in working in big missions in Pakistan and in Egypt as well, I spent 4 years in Cairo, is that the Council and the Embassy are aligned on making sure that there is one big UK story. Now for us, of course, we're representing the whole of the UK, and we don't have ministers, so we're able to align ourselves in very practical terms and very relatively straightforward terms with what the UK is trying to achieve through the country planning process. And the FCDO, of course, have their planning processes and how we all align with those and how we connect into those That takes some doing. That's just two systems talking to each other. But we have been doing this for 85 years, working very closely with the Foreign Office overseas. And I think where the UK presents itself and sets out the whole waterfront is where we become most attractive. It's where we become most influential, where you have a brilliant, for example, development operation and a trade mission and culture and education. And it's what our competitors are doing. I mean, this is the one thing I wanted to add, that soft power is a very competitive space. There is a competition for influence on over the choices that young people and their parents and policymakers make. You know, we don't quite know how much China spends, but we think it's in the region of about $10 billion a year through the growth and their expansion. So that, and our EU friends and the Americans, they're all in it. So this is competitive. So really, I think it's about all of us saying, what is the thing that we can do best in soft power, in culture and education, and particularly with the culture and education being devolved and a brilliant manifestation of everything that Scotland has to offer. How do we make sure that we work together to deliver a really good outcome that maintains our reputation and that delivers influence as well? Because a lot of other actors are active in this space.
Thank you very much. Convener, I've got one general question, but I see the time is already 1 minute past 10, so I'm happy to hold it.
No, I think we've got a few more minutes. If you want to ask it, Donald, that's fine.
Thank you so much. There's been a lot of discussion about, you know, what, you know, in a best case scenario, what could be done by both your organisations. But obviously, I think, as we all accept, you know, resources are limited, both government resource and your own resources. I suppose I'm asking for a shopping list of your top three ambitions for the next few years, as quickly as you could. What would they be? I appreciate you've put detailed submissions, and it's a bit glib of me to attempt this, but it just if you could perhaps start with you, Mr. Hampson.
Networks, collaboration, mobility.
Very good. Professor Nolan?
Can I just say one thing? I didn't say through my evidence that we value the British Council offices enormously when we work internationally. I wanted to make that clear, that we work all the time. I think first and foremost is that direction from Scottish Government through the education strategy targets clarity. The second thing is that behind that is some investment. We're not talking masses. We're talking small amounts around scholarships, around mobility schemes. And I think a real push on the branding of Scotland, on the marketing of who we are as a study destination, what we offer and what's distinctive about it.
Very helpful indeed. Thank you very much. Sorry to put you on the spot like that at the end, but that's a really useful way to finish. Thank you, convener.
Thank you. I actually have a couple of final questions as well, different ones, if I could go. Firstly, to Professor Nolan, and it's something you touched on, Professor Nolan. It was this idea that what Turing is missing is that what I think is both sides of the same coin in the inward mobility of the exchange programme with students. And I just wondered if you could maybe comment on how you would like to see the future in terms of. And just explain to us why it's so important that it's a sort of two-way street, both in terms of students and lecturers or other researchers having that opportunity to exchange in both directions.
Yeah, it's important to, I think, for partnerships, for good partnerships that are going to be sustained and become more multifaceted, they've got to be mutually beneficial. So if one university thinks, well, I'm taking all these students from Edinburgh and Napier, but actually, and it's wonderful to have them, but why can't my students have the opportunity to go to Edinburgh and experience at the university, the city? So I think a feature of partnership development is mutual. What do we both get out of this? And students coming into it'll be interesting to see with Erasmus over the next 2 or 3 years how inward flows of students change. The pandemic has really muddied the water. But are they going to go to, you know, our French students or to America or not America, but are they going to go to maybe some of the Scandinavian countries? And how will that impact our classrooms? We had a healthy inbound numbers of EU students, and they really make a difference to our classroom, to the students they mix with. So features of that scheme in mutual or reciprocality, whatever the word is really important for developing the partnership and for adding on other things for developing research relationships. And it's the same with staff. You know, we benefit so much when staff come and spend some time with us. We learn about their ways of teaching, their approaches to research, their approaches to assessment, whatever. So I don't think it just can be a one-way street. And to repeat again, the aspect of Turing that I really thought was progressive was that target on more disadvantaged students, but also the shorter term ability. Because I guess early on in my career, I would have thought, oh no, surely 4 weeks wouldn't make a difference, but it actually does. 2 weeks can make a difference. I've had nursing students, you know, with caring, who've gone away for 2 weeks to another country, and it has literally, they say, transformed their lives. So, reciprocity and that short-term and targeted scheme, I think, would be enormously beneficial for Scottish students and staff.
Thank you very much. And a final question to Mr. Hampson, which touches on my first question. At a time when things have been changing so much in our relationships, you know, it's interesting to probe maybe some of the weaknesses that we had previously. And this is no way diminishing from the absolute success that the Edinburgh Festival is and the summer festivals in Edinburgh. But we also have other festivals in Scotland, the Wigton Book Festival at one end of the country. But I'm thinking specifically of the St Magnus Festival in Orkney. And I'm just wondering how you see us being able to take advantage at the moment of perhaps the Nordic relationships and the Copenhagen office in actually building the status of the other festivals across wider Scotland, so that we're not always thinking of the summer festivals being Edinburgh going forward.
That's a great challenge. Can I just absolutely and entirely back up and support what Professor Nolan said about mutually beneficial relationships? Because you build the trust that I've been talking about and all the benefits that come from it if you do that and you do it well. On your point about, you know, I've talked a lot about the whole of the UK. I mean, so to your point, the whole of Scotland. And I think that is a really, really good challenge for us. Are we representing the whole of Scotland in our arts work? I would like to think that our brilliant arts team do. I mean, certainly the Celtic Connections, for example, but again, that's Glasgow, isn't it, really? So I think what I don't have in front of me is a brilliant answer to a really good question, or even a good answer to your question. We do know that there's work that's gone on between Shetland Arts and a programme in Texas, for example, but that's not really to the point that you made around the Nordics. So can I undertake to you, convener, to write and say this is what has happened in a bit more detail, and actually maybe these are some of the things that are in the pipeline. I mean, I do see from my notes there is some work between the workroom in Glasgow and the Nordics. So again, Nordics on the radar, but maybe not quite in terms of the geography that you pinpointed in Scotland. So we'll write to you on that if that's okay, and we'll set that in detail, a proper response to your answer, because it's a great challenge. You know, whole of the UK, but it's got to be the whole of Scotland too.
Yeah, that's great. Thank you very much. And thank you both for your attendance at committee this morning. That's been immensely helpful to the committee. And again, a thank you for your submissions, which again were very helpful too. I'm going to suspend the committee until 10:15, and we'll return then for a session with the Cabinet Secretary. Thank you. Welcome back to our committee this morning. Our next agenda item is agenda item 3, and it's a final session or an inquiry into the Scottish Government's international work. And we are joined by Angus Robertson, MSP, Cabinet Secretary for the Constitution, External Affairs and Culture, Scottish Government, John Primrose, Deputy Director of International Relations, Scottish Government, and a change to the panel due to technical reasons. We're welcoming Neil Watt, Head of European Engagement at the Scottish Government. I'm going to welcome you all to the meeting, and Cabinet Secretary, thank you for being with us, and can invite you to make an opening statement.
Thank you very much, Convener, and delightful to be. I'm kind of losing track of how many times I've been with you recently. I think this is my fifth or my sixth evidence session with you. Delighted to be back and happy to answer the committee's questions. First, I wanted to take the opportunity to make a few remarks about events this week, not least because of what they may mean for the powers and the role of your committee. On Monday, the UK government published its, as it called it, Benefits of Brexit document to mark the second anniversary of the United Kingdom leaving the European Union. As a political distraction from events at number 10, clearly it failed. No surprise it failed. The simple truth of the matter is that there is a profound absence of Brexit benefits, whereas the disbenefits are all too evident. New polling this week has shown that 75% of people in Scotland have a negative opinion about whether the UK has benefited from Brexit, and only 2% of people in Scotland believe that Boris Johnson has delivered a good Brexit deal. Clearly, for people in Scotland, the proclaimed benefits of iconic blue passports and crown markings on pint glasses is frankly small beer that does nothing to redress the significant step backwards that Brexit has had on our trading position within the European Union and the wider benefits of EU membership. Now, the paper celebrates an ambitious export strategy, but the truth is that Scotland's total trade with the EU fell by 24% in the year to September 21 compared to 2019. For example, Scotland can no longer export the 20 to 30,000 tonnes of seed potatoes that we used to sell to the EU and Northern Ireland. The paper boasts of securing trading deals, but even the UK government's own research shows that there's little or no economic benefit from the new agreements that have actually been signed. The paper also boasts of highly resilient food supply chains, with no acknowledgement of the significant labour shortages being experienced across sectors, especially in rural Scotland. The paper celebrates taking back control of our waters, neglecting to mention that the total UK fish exports in the first 4 months of 2021 were 27% lower than the same period in 2018. And because of new UK immigration rules, an average of 20-25% of vacancies are unfilled throughout the seafood industry. The paper trumpets new initiatives to tackle criminal activity, but the reality is that post-Brexit, we're now outside key policing tools like the Schengen Information System, the European Arrest Warrant, and this makes things much harder for Police Scotland to combat criminality and for prosecutors to bring people to justice in Scotland. Paper claims that it will cut £1 billion of red tape, ignoring that UK government officials estimate that British companies trading with Europe will have to fill an extra 215 million customs declarations at a cost of a whopping £7 billion a year. Also ignores that cutting red tape usually simply means undermining environmental standards, undermining workers' rights, undermining quality standards, bad in itself and a sure way to trigger significant further disputes with the European Union under the Trade and Cooperation Agreement. And the UK government promised that the UK Shared Prosperity Fund would, at a minimum, match the size of EU structural funds in each nation each year, but current spending plans fall far short of replacing EU funds. And the reality is that the levelling up, as it's put, announced yesterday for Scotland actually means losing out. And that's not all. Don't worry, Convener, I'm not going to talk for much longer, although there's very little good news.
Cabinet Secretary,
really point out the bad. And I'm sorry to interrupt you.
Just to be absolutely clear, we're not taking evidence on the proposals in this bill. today, and we were very much focused on the international offices and our inquiry into how that works. And while I appreciate there is an overlap in these areas, due to time constraints, if you could concentrate on our inquiry into the operation of the international offices, I'd very much appreciate it.
Absolutely understood, convener, and was just entering my peroration by because it impacts on the work of the offices, impacts on the work of the Scottish Government, will impact on the work of the committee. That, I mean, it's unacceptable for us that the UK government seems ready to unveil sweeping measures that will have such profound consequences on Scotland, on the government, on the parliament, on your committee, with such little discussion or respect for the parliament and for the government. And the manner in which we're informed about the document makes a mockery of the UK government's recent commitment to reset relationships with the devolved governments.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. I'm going to move straight to questions from the committee, and I can invite Dr. Allen to begin.
Thank you, convener. I'm not sure if you can see and hear me.
Can you see
me? You're here with us today. Okay. Thank you, and thank you, Cabinet Secretary. We've heard evidence from the last panel, I don't know if you heard it, about the benefit that our offices internationally have, and quite an interest, I think, in having more of them. So maybe I can open by asking what the ambitions are for further countries to benefit from a Scottish presence around the world.
Well, thank you very much, Dr. Allen. And I think that it's fantastic that there does appear to be general agreement and general enthusiasm for the excellent job that Scotland's international offices do. They attract investment, they broaden our horizons, they create domestic opportunities and benefits people in Scotland, and do so at a very marginal cost in the context of the Scottish Government budget, between 0.01 and 0.02% of the Scottish Government's overall portfolio spending plans goes towards our existing 8 international offices. The funding going forward, which is allocated in the Scottish budget, includes the funds for the opening of our office in Copenhagen this year, which I think offers us huge opportunities for developing our links with the entire Nordic and Baltic region. These are our near Northern European neighbours, and that's going forward. Within this Parliament, we are committed to opening an office in Warsaw, serving Central Europe, again a region that matters enormously for us. And not just in trade and the likes of education and cultural exchange, but also because we have so many people who live in Scotland originally from that part of the world, and that makes perfect sense. I think there's an interesting discussion to be had about where does the network develop at the next stage, given that there seems to be so much encouragement for the network to be as successful as it can be. I can definitely look at parts of the world where we're not currently represented with a Scottish Government office. We do, of course, see Scottish representation through Scottish Trade International, and that is right around the world. The question is, where might we look next? Is it capitals where there's a strong bilateral connection, a strong cultural connection? Some cities have got a very strong multilateral diplomatic and third sector presence. So all of that, those factors will go into the thinking of where might we expand after Copenhagen and after Warsaw.
Thanks. One of the other things we heard in the last panel was about how that there's an opportunity now to draw together, if you like, a policy and activity in different strands of the government's work. So, for instance, that would be cultural activity, it would be economic development, it would be education. So, in thinking about the future and where future offices might be, does that factor in your thinking how offices could draw together different strands of government activity and perhaps look at what the universities are saying about where they'd like to see further activity?
Well, for those of you in the committee who've had the good fortune to visit Scotland House in Brussels, you'll be aware that there's been a long history of cooperation between different Scottish organisations that have a locus, in this case in a European context. And so in the past there was representation from the Convention of Scottish Local Authorities, for example, as well as the Scottish Government, as well as the Scottish Parliament, and so on. And so, yes, I think there's more that can be done in terms of coordination. That it already takes place between Scotland House and other Scottish agencies that are currently represented on the ground. So there's a very high level of cooperation between people who answer to Scottish Enterprise internationally on the ground. But you make the point about other strands of work that can be undertaken as part of an enlarged network, and that's absolutely true, and that is something that we will look at. But you might also say that that could be the case for places that we already have a presence. So take, for example, Paris, where there's a very successful Scottish Government representation. It's also a capital city, not just for France, but it also is home for the United Nations agency UNESCO, which is in charge of education and culture, both devolved areas. And so it seems to me that there are areas where we can be broadening and deepening the work that we do in places we are already represented, but we can also be looking at places that we aren't yet, but should be looking at in the future. And I would want to signal to the committee, I'm really interested to hear your views on where you think we should be looking next. Our network is very comparable with other devolved parts of the world. One wants to look at Quebec or Flanders or German Länder, for example. We're at a very comparative size, but these other places are increasing their networks often, and we know the benefit that we've been gaining. I know that you've taken evidence from colleagues who are in charge of Scotland House operations in a number of capitals. And these are extremely talented people. I wish to put on record my appreciation for all of the work that they do and that their staff do. But I think it definitely makes me think that we need to grab every opportunity with both hands to make sure that Scotland is represented as widely as we can make that happen, so that we can enjoy the benefits that such representation brings.
If I can turn to another area, but also under your responsibilities, although you have a new minister responsible for it, Neil Gray, international development. There's obviously a lot of reciprocity in the relationship that exists between Scotland and the countries we work in, most famously Malawi, but also in other countries as well, not least in Zambia. I just wonder if you could say a bit about what it is that is changing, because there's obviously been a review of our international development policy. There's been a keenness on the part of government to challenge our own assumptions about how international development is done. There's been talk about removing the white gaze, if you like, from the way we do international development. Can you say a bit about what is changing, so we can understand it as a committee?
Yeah. Well, the first thing I'd like to say is that travel restrictions have not meant that I or colleagues have been able to travel to speak to people on the ground in our partner countries. But I have had the benefit of meeting with diplomats from our partner countries during my most recent visit to London in Scotland House, the excellent representative office that we have there. And I know, speaking to the diplomats from our African partner countries, the tremendous appreciation that there is for the work that Scotland plays in international development terms. But you're right to point out that there has been a review to make sure that what we are able to deliver on the ground is frankly that what people in these countries are looking for, rather than perhaps priorities made in Northern Europe, as we might think of them being important for our friends and colleagues elsewhere in the world. So in terms of the reorientation of our principles of international development in the review, there are four changes that I can highlight to you, one of which is to build back fairer and stronger. That's an evolution of our funding, so how we structure, restructure our current funding streams, so number one. Number two, a Global South Programme panel. And that's, that was announced in our programme for government, that we'd establish a panel of experts by experience who principally work and reside in the Global South. So that's the point that I was trying to make about making sure that we are having that key input from people in the countries that we're working with, led at a ministerial level to help us ensure that Global South voices are being properly heard. Third area is updating our funding criteria to make sure that we're actually delivering that which we're wanting to deliver and have the impact that we want to have in our partner countries, and focusing our offers. The fourth, which is to ensure that our international development offer is focused on the best matches which are needed and the asks from the partner countries that we're working in. So those are the four key areas that I would highlight to the committee.
Thank you, Convener.
Thank you. Can I invite Mr. Golden, please?
Thank you, Convener. Cabinet Secretary, we received a written submission from Oxfam, which states, in a quote, "Scotland's credibility on climate justice is now in significant jeopardy due to it missing three successive annual emissions targets." Now, I appreciate delivery of climate targets is not in your portfolio directly, but is this having an impact on Scotland's international effort?
Well, nice to see you, Mr. Golden, and your amazing clock still in its place, telling me where I am in terms of the timing of my evidence session. I spent a lot of time in at the recent climate change talks in Glasgow, where I spoke with colleagues from around the world. And Scotland is held in extremely high regard because what we are achieving, and I hope not in a preachy way to the rest of the world, but you know, we are very fortunate that we have won on the natural resources lottery twice, once with oil. And we are now pivoting away from hydrocarbons, as we know we must, and we are an extremely fortunate country to have a very disproportionate amount of renewables potential, and we are trying to make the most of it. I don't think this is a party political issue. I think all of us know that we need to grab this opportunity with both hands. And I think in that area, we have a lot that we can help and share with countries who are trying themselves to do their best, as we all are, to deal with a climate emergency. So when speaking, for example, with the Malawians, and was speaking to the Malawian president who was here, he was here in Edinburgh, an event that I was speaking at, we're exceptionally keen to work with the Scottish government, so that we can share best practice and any learnings that we have to share with them. And just as importantly, what can we learn from our partner countries? It's not, I mean, we don't know everything and we don't have the answers to everything, and there will be things that we can learn as well. So, I mean, I think it's right that we need to do everything to make sure that we are reaching the targets that we set ourselves, but you know, we are setting amongst the highest targets in the world. And most other countries in the world are significantly behind where we are. So I think we do still hold a leadership role and responsibility to make sure that we are continuing to do everything that we can on the renewables front. But to work with our partner countries, I think, is one of the great prizes that we should be focusing on in our international development priorities going forward.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. We've heard lots of evidence about the positive nature of the Scottish Government's work internationally. But taking on your answer to my earlier question, have you considered a thematic approach to complement the geographic approach that we are currently pursuing in order to get more bang for the buck, if you like, you know, looking at renewables or water? Just
yep. A thought. No, and it's more than a thought, and it's absolutely right. And that is what we're doing. That's One of the areas where we are focusing our efforts relates to women and girls, which I think is going to be a very important factor for that. So that is a thematic approach, yes, and there can and there should be others. I'll signal to John Primrose, who I know is on the call and has a great deal of experience in this area, to maybe come in at the end of my comments here to underline this point. But we are taking a thematic approach, but we shouldn't be hidebound by that, because we can do a number of things at the same time, hopefully. And whilst the women and girls strand is very important for us moving forward, I think there are others that will also be a key priority. And if you know, we are amongst the world's leading countries when it comes to renewables and coming to that climate ambition, I think that could and should also be one of our key approaches for our work going forward. John, is there anything that you want to add to what I've just said there?
Thank you very much, Cabinet Secretary, and thank you also for the question with regards to thematic versus partnership countries. I mean, I think geographically speaking, which I think is partly where this question is coming from, I think it's right on the international development side that we're pretty focused in the three sub-Saharan African countries where we're currently investing, given the size of the budget portfolio. You know, just to give a bit of a scale on this, it looks likely by the end of our parliament, we'll be spending about £25-26 million primarily in these three partner countries, which is a really meaningful amount of money and a meaningful area for engagement, but wouldn't be if we diversified across multiple areas. That said, within that, it's absolutely right and proper that we're specialising thematically and leaning into the extensive skill sets which already exist within Scotland to ensure we're maximising the benefits for our partnership countries. So, for example, Cabinet Secretary already referred to renewables as a key area of partnership that we can do, and also on the climate justice side. I'd also say health and add that very much to that area. We've got an excellent NHS Global Citizenship Programme that has done extensive partnerships with Malawi and now also Zambia. So there's a range of areas where Scotland is excellent and that we can partner with extensively with international developing countries. And we are thinking about these policy beams, which were outlined within the global review, to the review that was outlined last March to Parliament. So I think it's basically essentially to answer the question, both very much a remaining focused geographic area, but also just accelerating and increasing the level of leadership that we can provide globally at policy level on these individual themes. Thanks.
Thanks, Mr. Primrose. Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. Back to you, Convener.
Thank you. Could I invite Mr. Ruskell, please?
Thanks, Convener. Couple of quick questions for me, Cabinet Secretary, for yourself and your officials. The first one is about the international relations order. I mean, firstly drawn up, I think, in 2013, a very different world. Can I ask you, has there been discussions about revising that?
Are you talking about the international framework of the Scottish Government?
The international relations concordat in the UK. So the concordat, which presumably, you know, governs the way that the different nations within the UK and the UK government actually work together. Imagine that on international relations.
Well, I mean, sorry, on a general point, there's been, as you know, a refresh on intergovernment relations, which was announced only a few weeks ago, involving the UK government and the devolved administrations in the UK. And you rightly point out that there was agreement after the onset of devolution, which underscores the opportunities that devolved administration, Scottish government included, can pursue on the international stage, which is exactly what we do. We focus largely on the areas of devolved responsibility that we have to maximise our opportunities internationally. Do we need to specifically revisit that agreement? That is not a subject that I'm currently involved in. to be frank, in the, if I want to call it this, the medium term, I think it would be much better for us to not be not have any form of restriction on Scotland's ability when it comes to European and international policy whatsoever. And I look forward to that being secured during this parliamentary term. But in the meantime, we will do everything that we can to make the most of the opportunities that, that we have. You may well be aware that most of our Scotland House operations are currently co-located within UK embassies. And there is a very high degree of cooperation and collegiality, and I very much welcome that. I know that our colleagues in the Scotland House networks value that, and I hope that colleagues in the Foreign Office value that. So, in answer to your question, we should always keep our formal relationships under review. My last thought on all of this would be, I don't lay the greatest store on these sort of formal arrangements, because we've had them up until now within the devolved settlement, and frankly they haven't worked tremendously well because there's not been a willingness to let them work very well. So the first thing is one actually needs to be minded to work positively with one another, and the good news is that on the ground, internationally, I think that that happens already. But if there are any specific observations or suggestions about the arrangements that were entered into after devolution, happy to take a look at that.
Mm. What you're saying then is that there's no real desire to look formally at that concordat or MOU, and it's very much being led by practice on the ground, and that appears to be working. Is that a fair summary, or is there any move to sort of revisit formally what those responsibilities relationships look like?
Well, I'm currently not looking at any update or changes to the current arrangements. As things presently stand, we have a network of international offices. We have excellent people working around the world, both for in the Scottish Government network, but then on our economic partners answering to Scottish Enterprise, working on the ground. We are managing to do what it is that we set out to do. Should and when Scotland's constitutional status change, then most certainly we're going to have to look at the network and the ending of their restrictions in terms of what they can do. I very much look forward to that, because normal countries are able to develop their international relations in an unrestricted way. But I don't think that's the scope of this morning's evidence session, but no doubt we will be coming back to that in the course of this Parliament as the Scottish Government's prospectus towards the independence referendum is published.
I'm sure we certainly will. So in terms of then the Scottish Government's international framework, when will that be reviewed and updated?
Well, this that was my initial query with you, Mr. Ruskell, in relation to the updated international framework. So that is extremely current. It has been worked on, and you'll be aware that this has been both a manifesto and a programme for government commitment. And we will be publishing the new global affairs framework this financial year. So within the next months, it sets out the Scottish Government's engagement internationally, the values that underpin that engagement, and it demonstrates our wish to be a good global citizen. We do have an important role to play in demonstrating high international standards, and we'll continue to support our internationalisation agenda to influence the world around us on the issues that matter. Most. That's probably the furthest extent I can go to in giving a sneak peek on what will be coming out shortly. But it will be coming out shortly.
Okay, that's good to hear. Final question: we took evidence a couple of weeks ago from the Scotland-Malawi partnership, and I think there was some considerable concern around the pulling of the Malawi small grant scheme. I think there were concerns that the scheme had been evaluated against objectives that were incorrectly written, and the full benefit of the scheme as it was operating wasn't properly evaluated and wasn't properly reviewed. I recognise, you know, that's quite a granular issue to kind of hit you with this morning, but I'm wondering if you're aware of those concerns and what commitment you might be able to give to ensure that they're properly addressed.
Yeah. So I am fully aware of the issue that you raise, and again, I'll signal to John Primrose that he may want to join at the end of my comments in relation to this. I think everybody appreciates that all schemes that involve us dispensing taxpayers' money is subject to review. That is a common practice, and we need to ensure that we are actually delivering against the aims that are set for particular projects or funding streams. I think the evaluation came to the view that it had not delivered against all of the criteria that the Scottish Government wished to deliver on the ground, having the impact that we want to see. And that's why, as we review and move forward with the projects that we support, and this is what my previous ministerial colleague Jenny Gilruth updated the Scottish Parliament on, was this thematic approach to women and girls that we are now focusing in. Now, we are going to continue to dispense small grant funds, but it's not going to be working in the same way as has been up until now, because it's been an evaluation, and the recommendation is that we should do things differently. The feedback that we've had from partner countries has been positive. I just share with you one: the government of Malawi has requested that Scotland finance fewer larger programmes, which would help them track progress and also manage alignment with their aims. So we're trying our best to work with our partners on the ground, making sure that the projects that we are supporting work best with them, but also work in line with the strictures that we put on them. John, do you want to come in on that? In essence, we want to make sure that what we're committed to is working, and if it's not working in the way that we intended it to work, then we have to pivot. We have to make sure that we are delivering in the way that we do want them to deliver, and with our partners in our partner countries. John, is that a fair assessment?
Absolutely, Cabinet Secretary, but if the committee is allowing me, then I'm prepared to give a bit more detail underneath that, just to go ahead with it. So, I mean, as Cabinet Secretary said, the objectives of this project at the outset, just to explain in a little bit more detail, as advocated by SNP and what was then the Alliance, were that it is important to allow very small organisations in Scotland, provide them capability support so that they can then start accessing much larger grants. That was one of the critical raison d'etre of the programme, and we evaluated it and found that there was only one organisation of 80 grants that was able to actually graduate to that larger area. So I think it's absolutely right to say that it didn't fulfil the objectives of which we'd set out at the outset. Now, I would also say there were a few other issues with it. For example, we'd actually anticipated much larger demand for the grants than there was. There was we anticipated 150 going out. In the end, there was 80. There's evidence also out there that the review took into account on the additionality of having much smaller projects versus larger projects. And actually, the evidence globally from an aid impact perspective is that it doesn't create more innovation or impact when you have a range of much smaller projects versus larger projects. There isn't positive evidence for that. And obviously, there's also a transaction cost issue. So on the basis of value for money and an external review that was done in collaboration, actually, with also the SNP and other organisations, we've taken that decision. I would say, just to add additional to that, and as Minister Gilruth, our former minister, said, we still remain incredibly committed to supporting civil society within the Global South. The, the three areas of concentration actually for the small grants programme, which were in health, education and economic development, we will continue to support our partner countries in and in fact increase the finance associated with it. I should also say that Scotland civil society and global citizenship overall within Scotland remains a critical focus for our programme, and we'll continue obviously to support, as we do already, Scotland civil society through a range of means, including our support to the Alliance and the SNP. So I think we have a difference of opinion there based on the evidence that we've seen with the SNP, but I would be keen for that not to be seen in any way to us disinvesting from the key priorities that we our partner countries have, or indeed our engagement on global citizenship in Scotland.
Okay, thanks. I mean, there's obviously a key role for small organisations, small initiatives to be established, and then they have the potential then to grow into bigger initiatives that could attract more funding. So I suppose I'm interested to know, maybe you could write to a committee or whatever, about how you're going to continue to support that growth of grassroots initiatives, which seem to attract such a huge amount of voluntary support and engagement across Scotland and in Malawi, and have the potential then to grow into bigger programmes over time. But I'll hand back to the convener just now.
Thank you very much. Could I invite Ms Boyack, please?
Thanks very much, convener. It's been an interesting discussion today, and definitely interested in the issues about sharing knowledge and expertise. And it was interesting here at the Cabinet Secretary talk about how we could share our knowledge and expertise on renewables. But of course, there's a learning from other countries as well. And I was thinking as he was speaking that Denmark in particular, something like 2/3 of their homes are heated by heat networks. And I think 3/5 of that is by biomass and not by fossil fuels. So it has to be a two-way process. Could I shift us on to the issue of what happens post-Brexit? Cabinet Secretary, you kicked off your comments to us today by talking about the shift, you know, 2 years on from Brexit. And this was an issue that came up with quite a few of our witnesses. And there were comments from two witnesses in particular, Dr. Kirsty Hughes and Anthony Salamone, who felt that we needed a better post-Brexit engagement approach and a better set of priorities. And I was wondering what the Cabinet Secretary's comments would be on that. And is there a new international development strategy to come, particularly in the light of the comments you made at the start about reduced trade relations with our neighbours in Europe?
Okay, well, firstly on interrelationships post-Brexit. I mean, I have spent a considerable amount of my time, as has Jenny Gilruth, and Neil Gray's already hit the ground running as her successor, in terms of our ongoing and continuing relationship with European partners, whether that is at a European institutional level or on a bilateral level. We have a very high tempo level of engagement to try and make sure that we we're still plugged into the thinking of European partners. Now, this obviously matters very directly. It's a very current issue. I mean, take for example what's going on with the Northern Ireland Protocol. We need to be fully sighted on what is happening with all of that, not least because under the current situation, we are set to have a border post constructed in Scotland as a result of the UK government's agreement with the European Union. Now, we know the UK government is resiling from its own agreement, and the news in the last 24 hours from Northern Ireland is extremely fast moving, and we probably don't have time to go into working out what that means, but we've had a Northern Ireland minister refusing to see border control posts operating. That's in direct contravention to the international agreement signed by the United Kingdom government. And since then, we've had the announcement that the First Minister in Northern Ireland is resigning. So, I mean, these things, today is a day when it's extremely dramatic, but it matters to us, and it relates directly with issues in and around Brexit and how we're supposed to be emerging beyond Brexit. So it kind of illustrates why it's so important for us to have continuing and deep and trusting relations with our interlocutors, and we are doing that. So are we going to do more of that? Well, yes, we have to have the best possible relations that we can. And that, incidentally, because I know you've had a particular interest in the workings of the Scottish representative offices, that is one of the things that they are able to do. They are able to nurture and further the relations that we have in Brussels, for example, but then in other European capitals, at which point I segue on to Sarah Boyack's other point. She was mentioning what we can be learning from other places, and the point about Copenhagen and Denmark is extremely well made. There are different things that we are probably best able to learn from different countries, and she highlighted environmental policy in Denmark, and I agree with her wholeheartedly. I think there's so much we can learn from our Nordic neighbours in that respect, but also in the cultural space. I think, as I've mentioned to the committee before, I think there's a lot we can be learning from Denmark and neighbouring countries about what they've been able to do in screen production and broadcasting. Many of us on the committee, I think, are acknowledged fans of Scandi Noir, and have been watching amazing television series that have come out from DR, the Danish public broadcaster, and I'm very keen to learn what they've been able to do so successfully there. So I think I've covered two of the bases. I don't know if Ms. Boyack wants to come back to me if there's something else that I missed. Firstly, on the European relations and making sure that we have the best possible direct connections with people, and secondly, what it is that we can be learning then in other capitals.
Yeah, absolutely. And in a way, I wanted to flag the Danish issue, because I know with the Copenhagen office, that's an opportunity. We've got to seize it with both hands. But it was to go back to my opening question about articulating a post-Brexit strategy. Totally get your point that things change day by day, but there is also something about those relationships and the points that Mark Ruskell made about international relations in terms of Concordat across the UK and, of course, with our partner countries in the European Union. So it was really the point made by previous witnesses about the need for a clear post-Brexit strategy, and then to articulate how that links the hubs that you've got abroad, and the extent to which you've got a way of increasing the transparency of how the hubs work. They're obviously not wanting to know absolutely everything, because there has to be a degree of give and take, but something in terms of key priorities and then the thematic approach. Maybe you've talked about that in terms of international development, but in European terms as well, you know, what our priorities are. And suggestion from some witnesses that we should be very tight, but of course also everybody suggesting the issues that they're actually interested in. So we've had educational, cultural links today. You've mentioned economic development and trade. We've got climate change. So just what is the strategy and what would be the objectives under those headings? And how do you link that to the hubs?
Sure. Well, I mean, the first thing, happy to share with you any specific questions that you have on this, because I know time is short for this evidence session this morning. But the work and the priorities of the hubs is not intransparent, and it's you know, the priorities that they have set it's something which is subject to assessment. We have five key outcomes against which the external network reports. It is on, firstly, Scotland's international reputation and improving it. Secondly, Scottish businesses and their ability to trade internationally and more effectively. That Scottish research and innovation capability is promoted and further partnership and funding is secured. Fourthly, that investment to Scotland is increased. And fifth, that Scotland's interests in the European Union and beyond are protected and enhanced. Now, those are the key headline objectives that the network works to. There will be nuance in different capitals because of the different priorities that we have in different places. So, for example, very easy to see that, for example, in Germany, we are pursuing
closer and enhanced relations, especially with German lender, in relation to renewable energy and hydrogen, because that really makes sense there. We've gone through the Danish. We've gone through the advantages of the Danish-based office, but you can go through the others. And one is working to those higher goals, and then there will be specific areas of focus. And you know, I think it's great that you heard directly from colleagues who are running Scotland Houses internationally. I'm delighted that you're able to ask them what they do. So that is transparency in action. I'm sure you will wish to invite them back. I speak to these colleagues extremely regularly. And they are very keen to be able to say what it is that they do and how they do it. And you know, so I encourage you to do that, to learn more about what they do, because on you know, these are by and large really quite small operations by sort of diplomatic standards. But we have some extremely talented people who are out there batting for Scotland. And they're doing a great job. So I think the more that we can hear about what it is that they do and the advantages that they bring will should enthuse and encourage everybody.
Okay, we'll pick that up. The post-Brexit strategy, did you have any comments on that? Obviously a moving agenda, but what would be the Scottish Government articulated that, or is there a briefing that we can circulate for to address the issues made by witnesses?
Well, obviously, one is talking about a fast-evolving situation, yeah. And we are moving with the situation as quickly as it moves. We don't have an end state at the moment. We were supposed to have international agreements and the basis of a new relationship between the United Kingdom and the European Union, but we're not there yet. I mean, we're still at a place where the United Kingdom is threatening to invoke Article 16. And you know the problems that would then bring for all of us in terms of a worsening relationship with the European Union. I mean, I would highlight two levels in which we are interacting with European colleagues. One of which is in relation to Brexit and its ongoing and unresolved issues, which we talk to people about. And secondly, it is those areas where we have kind of emerged beyond the immediate wreckage of the Brexit process. So, for example, on education, we know that what has been transpiring with the Erasmus scheme, for example, we know that its UK replacement is inadequate when measured against it. Nevertheless, we still want to make sure that we have the best possible relations with other European countries, in this case, education, which is why I was speaking with the German federal minister who has responsibility for this, because we want to make sure that we have the best possible relations. Or when I spoke a few weeks ago with the French culture minister, talking about how we can move beyond the problems that Brexit has caused for both Scottish but also for French artists, and how it has made it much more difficult for them to tour and perform. So we are working on two levels. One, how do we deal with the immediate issues? But two, how do we move beyond them? So and that is exactly what we're doing. But it's, you know, some things are moving very quickly, and we just have to deal with the fast moving circumstances. But on the other, we are doing exactly that which you pointed out, which is working out where are the different areas where we can kind of move beyond the sort of immediate Brexit transition issues to try and firm up and, in some respects, ameliorate the damage that Brexit has caused.
Okay, thank you for that. And just to say, very worth checking out the discussion we had in the first panel about the educational connectivity and the new Welsh scheme that was announced this week. I think interesting lessons for us to look at. Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. Thanks, Convener. Yep.
Thank you very much, Annie. I know the Cabinet Secretary has already spoken about the time, but if we could be mindful of that going forward. But we have two final members to come in, and invite Ms Minto first, please.
Thank you, Convener, and thank you, Cabinet Secretary. Your answer to Ms Boyack preempted one of my questions, which was around the evolving and developing situation currently in Northern Ireland and the impact on Scotland. However, we took evidence from David McAllister, MEP, about the fact that Scotland can pursue a different and more informal engagement with the EU. And I think the first time you came to the committee, I asked you about the connections that you were making from the more softer side of connections through culture, through education, through design, and Scandi Noir. So I'd be interested to hear a wee bit more about that, if possible. And then also, you commented a bit on the wider diaspora and learning from the situation in Flanders or perhaps Quebec, how they engage on the world stage. Sorry, I've rolled a few questions into one there.
It is, and I'm going to get myself into all kinds of trouble with the convener because I could happily talk about these areas for a long time. On the diaspora point, I have a locus in this because I also have responsibility in relation to the population challenge that we're facing, and I don't know how widely aware people are of the fact that we're heading back into the territory of relative decline in population terms, which is very concerning for us. And so that is the background to the kind of perennial challenge stroke opportunity that we have, though, is that we are one of those nations in the world that has a very significant diaspora. And the question then is, how do we best maintain, discover, maintain, develop the relationship with that diaspora, which is not, you know, I think in the past people just thought, well, that, you know, that's largely people who left Scotland and went to the United States, Canada, Australia, New Zealand, and so on. But there are other forms of diaspora as well. For example, there are literally tens of thousands of people who have studied in Scotland and then gone back to the countries that they came from originally, and they are a form of Scottish diaspora as well. They're aspirational Scots. And we need to find imaginative ways of striking a continuing relationship with these people and making the most out of that. So we have lessons to learn from other countries. Some were mentioned. I would add Ireland very closely to that. The Irish have a great experience of fostering a relationship with their diaspora. And I think there's more to come on that. I'll be happy to come back to the committee when there's more that I can say about that. But it's definitely something that we are thinking about, and we're working out how we can move all that forward. In terms of the sort of softer areas, as it was put in relation to the likes of culture and education, well, I mean, it's relatively simple for me because I'm Cabinet Secretary for External Affairs and Culture, so I can do both at the same time. And I think what we always need to keep an eye on are the areas of Scottish government policy which also have that kind of interaction. So education was mentioned, and I know that is definitely something that Shirley-Ann Somerville is extremely focused on, and we do talk about. And another area we haven't really got into is justice, because you know, we are in the unfortunate position that we have, through Brexit, lost our place in a great many judicial cooperation functions. And now that's the bad news. The good news, if you can call it that, is that Scottish Government is working very well across directorates, across areas of expertise. We had a recent deep dive, as it's called in the jargon, that was hosted by colleagues in Scotland House in Brussels. Another example of the value that the network brings, of colleagues who work there and are working in this field, and were able to brief my Cabinet Secretary colleague Keith Brown, justice officials, my own directorate, and others. And I think that's just a sort of concrete illustration of how we are moving beyond Brexit, if we can call it that, understanding the downsides, the very, very few upsides, as I pointed out in my initial statement, and what is it that we're going to do about it. And there are some things that we can find workarounds for, but, you know, the honest truth is there are many things that we can't. So we need to be honest with people out there that Brexit has been extremely damaging, and yes, on trade, but also on education, on culture, on justice, and other areas as well. And but you know, we are going to have an opportunity during this parliamentary term to put that right and chart our course for rejoining the European Union as an independent member state, and that will go a long way to repairing the damage that Brexit has wrought on us.
Thank you for that, Cabinet Secretary. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you. And can I finally invite Mr Cameron, please?
Thank you, Convener. Good morning again, Cabinet Secretary. I've got two sort of broad sort of areas of questions. And the first is about where the Scottish Government's international presence is at the moment in terms of hubs. I mean, plainly, there is a kind of predominance towards the EU. And, you know, notwithstanding differences of opinion about Brexit, about Scotland's constitutional future, etc., resources are limited. Do you think that we are in the right place at the moment in the context of not being in parts of the world like Asia or South America or Africa? And if there is to be a refocus or an expansion, what are the criteria to decide where Scotland goes? But what are the precise criteria? You mentioned the diaspora, you mentioned cultural links. I'd just like to try and pin that down, if possible.
Thank you very much, Mr. Cameron, and I concur with the underlying sentiment of the question, which is about the attractiveness of expanding the network. I've not heard anybody suggest that where we are currently located is the wrong place to be. Far from it. I think the cities that we're in, the countries that we're in, are absolutely places that we need to be. And the question then is, where next? I think the decisions that were made, and these precede my time in office, that we should be looking to Copenhagen and then to Warsaw, I think makes significant sense. But I think you're also right to ask, so where next? I think you could say, well, given their importance, what about the Asian subcontinent, countries that we have close cultural and historic connections with? You might point to Pakistan and India. You might highlight the importance of Japan as a trading partner. You might pass comment about Australasia as a part of the world where we have strong and historic connections and currently still do in trade and tourism. You would be right to say, you know, where is the presence in Africa, and when that happens, and I'm sure it will, where would we be best suited to doing that? We do, of course, have partner countries there. So, is it physically in one of those, or are there regional capitals where there is a multilateral presence as well? There are a number of factors that come into play in making any assessment of where next. I mean, obviously, I think I take a different view to you on the scope ultimately of the best network that Scotland could have, and I have no difficulty in saying I look forward to Scotland being represented on all of the continents of the world. But you know, even the biggest states in the world have limits to their international networks. So there is a process to be worked through about where next. And as I signaled to Dr. Alistair Allen, I'd be very happy to hear the views of the committee, of members of the committee, of where they think it is that we should be looking next. I don't think there's a monopoly of common sense in this. But you know, I'm content where we are. I think where we're going next makes perfect sense, and I look forward to the network being expanded even further. And I'm delighted to see that there seems to be cross-party agreement on that in the committee as well.
Thank you for that. I suppose just to try and pin this down a bit further. I mean, it's very easy to sort of build up a wish list of places and different reasons, but I'm wondering what are the criteria? Are they economic? Are they cultural? Are they diaspora related? I'm just not entirely sure that we know exactly what the factors are to be taken into account if there is a refocus of some sort. But I'm content to leave it there and just move on to the next set of questions, which is about one of the issues that the committee is looking at in this inquiry is how the Scottish Government effort internationally works with the UK a diplomatic effort. And you spoke at the start about co-location of hubs within embassies in some parts of the world. And I just wondered, are there any other practical examples of that sort of interaction? And your officials may be able to give some. I was struck by, on social media, the High Commission, the Canadian High Commission in the UK, promoting an event held by the Quebec office in London. And I just wondered, is that the sort of thing that is happening in UK embassies abroad in terms of the Scottish Government efforts? And also, are there any examples of the Scottish Government international hubs working with anything that other devolved nations are doing, like Wales and Northern Ireland? Is there any practical examples of that kind of cooperation or coordination?
So again, I mean, could really talk at great length about all of this, and I don't think we're going to be able to do this justice, especially given what the convener was saying about being pithy answers. In speaking with colleagues in our current network, I'm always struck by, we're involved in this initiative or that event. Now, obviously, this is taken with the COVID restrictions very much in mind, having sort of limited the ability to do a lot of conventional outreach work, the kind of soft diplomatic work that takes place. But it's been interesting to, for example, I was speaking in the last week with a new Welsh representative in Brussels about what it is that they're hoping to achieve for the Welsh government, and me saying to them that they should please feel free to work as closely as possible with our colleagues on the ground. And I would hope very much that there is a professional relationship with the UK mission to the European Union. So Neil Gray, within the last week, was speaking with the British ambassador to the European Union in Brussels. I mean, I can go on and on and on about where things work well. I can point to other things where I think there's room to grow. I noticed, I don't want to embarrass them, so I won't even mention the continent, but a British embassy in a significantly sized country talking with pride about them hosting their first ever Burns Supper, which kind of makes me wonder why in the last 200 years they haven't been able to host one up until now. It kind of shows that there are ways in which we can help influence the UK diplomatic network to make more of the opportunities to promote Scottish culture, Scotland in a general sense. So there is an opportunity to work well together. I hear lots of examples of that being the case, and in all constitutional eventualities, look forward to that continuing to be the case. I would draw attention to the fact that when talking about co-location, there's some really good examples of that working well. The Nordic nations share an embassy in Berlin, and I think I'm right in saying the United Kingdom and Germany shares an embassy in Reykjavik. So there are all kinds of ways in which we can work with one another in terms of international networks. Being imaginative and being supportive of one another, I think, would be a thoroughly good thing.
Thanks for that. My final question is about measuring success, and as something that I think the committee is really trying to grapple with in this inquiry in terms of kind of what are the metrics that we use to measure success here, given public money is obviously being expended. And I just wondered if you had any sort of concrete thoughts about how we measure success in terms of what we're doing, how we get value for money, etc.
Yep. So I'm going to read this because I think this is quite important. Offices use a range of both qualitative and quantitative indicators to measure their performance. Evaluation reports for the international offices in 2019-20 have been published under FOI, as has the evaluation report for Scotland House Brussels in 2018-19. There's both an evaluation process, which is continuous and ongoing to make sure that the work that is undertaken by the Scottish offices is measurable. And secondly, it is transparent and it is available to the public. So I think it's good that people are aware of that. One is aware of the five key outcomes that we ask of the network, the fact that there is an evaluation process and the fact that it is publicly available. But in addition to that, I think it's really helpful, and this is where the committee has performed an important function, by being able to see the people who are actually out there doing the job. And I know that you had colleagues from Scotland House in London, in Brussels and Berlin. No doubt you will speak to others going forward in the future. Just being able to hear from them about what it is they do, how they do it. And the thing that is I find tremendously encouraging is when you meet not just the people who run the representative offices that we have, but the other members of the team. I spent an afternoon last week speaking via Teams call to the staff of Scotland House in Brussels, an amazing international polyglot, enthusiastic staff complement there. And they are there working every single day to promote Scotland across the piece. And I think we should be very grateful for what they do. So I probably now 20 minutes past 11, I know I'm getting to the end of my time. So I'll abuse the position by again just saying a big thank you to everybody who does their best to try and promote all of our interests, our economy, our culture, our education and all of that. They're doing a great job and long may that continue.
Thank you, Convener.
Thank you very much. That concludes consideration of this agenda item. I would like to thank the Cabinet Secretary, remind him that we're not expecting the committee next week, which I'm sure he's relieved about. But thank him and his officials for the attendance this morning. And the committee will now consider its work programme in private. And I'll close this part of the meeting and ask members to log on to Microsoft Teams for our next agenda item. Thank you very much for your attendance.